Let's do that. Okay. Okay, so does anybody have any problem with the English language? No.
No.
Everybody can speak in English. So I can try to speak in English. And if I have some problems in some part of the presentation, I'll switch to Italian. Okay. Okay, so let's start. Now I will share. Where is it? Okay, let me, one second here. Okay. Okay, now we are ready. Okay. Okay, can you all see La Primavera di Botticelli?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Can you hear me well? Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Okay,
fine. Yes, all is perfect.
Excuse me?
All is perfect.
Fantastic.
Go on.
Fantastic, fantastic. Okay, maybe I zoom a little bit. Okay, there we go. So now today we talk about this masterpiece. You know, probably you have seen it once. You can find this masterpiece in the Uffizi Museum in Florence, Firenze. And it's probably one of the most known masterpieces in art masterpieces in the world, I suppose, no? And the name of this famous painting is La Primavera di Sandro Botticelli. Sandro Botticelli is the painter. He lived, as you can see here, now this is the date of the painting. He lived basically in the 15th century, and he was in Florence, okay? He was born in Florence, he lived the whole time in Florence, and he served for all his life the famous Medici family, okay? So I think all of you guys can, I mean, anyone in the world can see that this is a very beautiful painting, right? So we don't have to be an expert to see that this is a gorgeous, you know, gorgeous painting, you know, so beautiful. But if you really want to understand what's behind this painting, we need to know some more things, you know? And now I'm going to go through these things that probably not everyone knows. Okay, so let me say first of all that for understanding this painting is very famous to dive in the period in which it was painted. You know? So we are in Florence, as I said, in the 15th century. These are the time in which it is supposed to be painted. So it's sometimes between 1478 and 1484. And this is the period in which we have in Florence the famous Medici family, okay? So we can say that everything started with this man on the left, whose name is Cosimo de' Medici. He was the very first one of the Medici family who made the city a very rich city. Because he was a banker, basically, he made a bank, and then he had, with this bank, agencies in all the regions, in all the Italian regions, but even outside from Italy, okay? So they had agencies in Paris, in Netherlands, and many, many, many other places. So this is the reason why basically Florence became such a rich city, you know, thanks to this man who basically was the most important person in the city, okay? So after him, he had a son. The son stayed not for a long time because he was quite sick. He stayed for about 3-4 years. His name was Piero. And then after him, we had Lorenzo. Mm-hmm. Lorenzo was the nephew of Cosimo. And with Lorenzo de' Medici, Florence reached the most important period of its history. Okay, so we are talking about, as you can see here, he lived between the mid-century until the end of the century, basically. No, this is the period of Lorenzo de' Medici, also said Lorenzo il Magnifico. Okay, what did they do? Well, they basically were very much in touch with the artists, okay? So, because, first of all, as I said, they were extremely rich, so they invested a lot of money in artworks, art masterpieces, but for another very important reason. They basically did the artists and the art production an important instrument for basically consolidating their power within the city. Okay, so this is what they did, and in fact, together with these important people, so we can see here on the left Marsilio Ficino. We studied in Italy at school something. He was an important philosopher at that time. He was forgotten because today we don't study him anymore, but definitely he was, at the time in which he lived, he was very well known, he was extremely important, and he lived very much together with the Medici family, and together with Angelo Poliziano, who was a famous writer at the time. We have then here our dear painter Sandro Botticelli. This is the only portrait, self-portrait we have of him, because this is basically his real face, okay? It's painted in another famous painting, which is called L'Adorazione dei Magi. And together with the Medici family, they founded in Florence what was called the Neoplatonic Academy, okay? So basically, this is still a beautiful house, still existing in Florence, and it's called Villa Careggi. So if you are familiar with Florence, Careggi is the area where today there is the major hospital of the city. It's a very nice area. It's up on the hills. And within this beautiful building, they founded the Neoplatonic Academy. So Neoplatonic Academy was especially founded by our philosopher Marsilio Ficino, together with Cosimo de' Medici, but then it's with Lorenzo de' Medici that became extremely strong with its production. And what did they do, basically? They promoted very much the Platonic philosophy, okay? So Plato, who was, as you know, a very famous philosopher in the Greek history. So we are talking about a period which is probably at least a couple of thousand years before, you know? So he became, he was basically rediscovered at this time, and all his theories became extremely important and popular, okay? Popular among, I would say, a restricted part of the society, which was the society of the cultured and the rich people, which was basically the people to which the family, the Medici family, belonged to, okay? So this is why Lorenzo de' Medici was really able to do. So basically, he had the great intuition to transform the art production in an instrument for consolidating his power. And this is what's happened. So what was basically the Neoplatonic expression? The Neoplatonic expression basically brought all the philosophical ideas of Plato. And within the Neoplatonic works, there are many symbolic meanings, many, many symbolic meanings that not everybody was able to understand. Only very few people who had the knowledge, the culture, and to understand them. That's why it created a kind of elitarian environment within Florence, okay? So having said that, we can go back to our painting, and we can say that this is probably the most significant Neoplatonic expression we can have within an artwork, okay? So if we want to understand this painting, we need to understand what I just said. You know, this is something that came out from the philosophy, from the Neoplatonic Academy, and that bring together all the Platonic philosophical theories. And through after, if we understand that, we can better understand the painting that now we are going to describe more in details. Is it clear? Anything? Is okay so far? Can you follow me? Okay. So now, I think I have some problems with my... Oh, Madonna. Okay.
Oh, so Madonna.
Now, yes? Sorry?
Va bene.
Va bene. Okay, now, so how can we read this painting? So it's necessary to read it from the right to the left, okay? From the right to the left. The correct way to understand this painting is by reading it from the right to the left. So who are all these people we can see right here? So we have, first of all, we have all the women in the middle. We have six women right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then we have only three male people at the border, which are this one, the baby up here, and this one here. So who are all these people? So first of all, as I said, we have to read it from the right to the left. So at the very right side, we have this person. This is supposed to be Zefiro. Zefiro, this is an allegory of a special wind that was called Zefiro. And this lady next to him was Chloris. So this comes from basically a legend that was written before by a Greek writer. His name was Hesiodo, and then it also inspired another Latin writer that was Ovidio, very famous for the Metamorphoses. So this episode you can see here comes from that writing of Hesiodo and Ovidio. So Greek culture and Latin culture. And it talks about Zefiro that basically conquers this young lady whose name was Chloris. And after they got together, and she started transforming in another person, which is the one you can see next to her. And the name of this person is Flora, in this painting, basically representing La Primavera, okay? So we have here Zefiro, Chloris. When they get together, they get in love together, and Chloris starts transforming herself. You can see here that she has some flowers and plants coming out from her mouth. So she's very slowly becoming like Flora. You can see here on the left. And so as you can see, Flora really represents the spring, you know, the spring. Flora, the name Flora also reminds the name of the city, because Flora in Latin was said Florencia. Florencia is Firenze. So it's clearly a celebration also of the city of Florence, okay? But then if you have, then let's have a look also at this lady. You know, you can see here, she has a very nice dress with so many flowers. She's spreading flowers all over around. And look at the flowers here, the flowers, the fruits. I'm not an expert in botanics, but they say that within this painting, there are probably around 500 different type of flowers, okay? So representing the springtime. And who was actually this lady, this so beautiful lady that Botticelli painted? She was actually a famous lady living in Florence at that time, whose name was Simonetta Vespucci. Now I'll show you some picture of this beautiful lady. This is Simonetta Vespucci, and she inspired not only, as you can see here, la flora della Primavera di Botticelli, but there are other paintings in which she was represented. This one, for instance, is very famous too by Botticelli. It's La Nascita di Venere, so it's Venus. So this is always Simonetta Vespucci, that was a kind of inspiring woman for our painter. But she was also very famous at her time, because what happened is that she came from Liguria. When she was 16, she got married with an important person in Florence, whose name was Giovanni Vespucci. And he was also a relative of the famous Amerigo Vespucci. We know he was one of the explorers that went to the New World in the 16th century. So this lady got married when she was 16 years old, but then she died at 23 years old, so she was still very young. So that's why she became a kind of, you know, legendary person for the artist in Venice. Also because she was supposed to be extremely beautiful, as you can see here in these portraits. But then if we go back to our painting, let's see who are the other people we can see here. So here we have, as I said, our flora. Have a look also at the feet, you know. It's very meaningful, the fact that these feet seems they are not touching the floor, you know? It seems that they are up in the air instead of touching the floor. This is also another Platonic idea. So everything, you know, which is related to Plato is very much related to what is spiritual instead of material, you know? So we can think about these bodies that they are not really made by, you know, materia, but more by spirit. That's why you can see any shadow of these bodies, and you have the feeling that those feet are not touching the floor, okay? But then who is this person right here in the middle? Well, this person is Venus, okay? This is Venus. And in Italian, è la Venere. And one other thing you may notice that all these women are pregnant. Can you see that? You know, all of them are pregnant because Venus was represented, of course, the beauty, the harmony, but also, you know, the regeneration ability, you know, the nature regeneration ability. So Venus, we can say that stays in the middle between the people we have on the right and the people we have on the left. And another thing you might see that the people on the right, they all have the arms going downwards, while the people on the right, their arms, they are going upwards. Why that? Because what we have here on the right, basically the people I just described, they are representing basically what is really passion, you know, the carnal passion we have on earth. while everything we have on the left represents more what is spiritual. And the transition between the two type of representation we have here is Venus. You know, Venus was of course this is in the Platonic vision. So I'm talking about the Platonic vision, you know. So Venus was the person who was able to encourage, you know, this transition between the carnal passion to the more spiritual passion we have on the right. Up here we have Venus' son, whose name was Cupido. Cupido, this is Venus, this is Cupido, her son, and he is shooting an arrow. If you look at here, he is shooting an arrow, and of course he is represented also blind. You see here, he has a kind of a blindfold here, and he's shooting an arrow with his arch towards this lady. This lady is one of the three graces. These are the graces, no? They are also, you know, an idea. Everything here comes from the ancient Greeks, you know. These are all characters very celebrated in the ancient Greek culture. The three graces come together with Venus to encourage this transition of love, beauty, and harmony towards the spiritual universe. So here we have Cupido, who is shooting the arrow towards this grace, whose name is La Castita. In Latin it was Castitas. I don't know the name in English, but maybe someone of you can help me. In any case, the three graces are Castita, Pulcritudo, which means beauty, and another one was the pleasure, you know, of course, the physical pleasure. So these graces represent these three three types of environment, I would say, human environment. And then if you look at this lady, so the arrow is about hunting her, but then she's looking at the man here, you know? Her eyes are looking this man, and this man, again, you can recognize him from his wingy shoes here, wingy shoes. This man was in the ancient Greek culture was called Hermes. Then within the Roman culture, the Latin culture, he became Mercurio. And who was Mercurio and Hermes? Basically, he was the god who had the responsibility of bringing messages. Basically, he was a messenger. He was a messenger for gods, you know. In this case, he's there to protect this beautiful garden, which is the garden of Venus, that wants to represent, in this case, the beauty, the harmony, and the spring, of course, you know, because here we have we want to celebrate the spring and the regeneration power we have coming with the spring. In this case, Hermes has a double function. One is for protecting this garden, even from the clouds, because right here you can see that he's trying to push away with this tool, whose name is caduceo in Italian, or even in Latin. He's trying to push away a cloud, a dark cloud, from this beautiful garden. So he's protecting this garden, at the same time, he's building a love union together with Castita, which is this lady. And then, of course, he is the one who will bring, you know, the beauty and the harmony coming from Earth right here up to the sky, basically, to a spiritual level. So basically, this is the meaning of this painting. Of course, there are many other details here. There are so many different type of trees. For instance, this is what is called the mirto, which was a tree that is always represented together with Venus, because she was very much attached to this type of plant. And then again, you know, I recommend anyone of you who has some passion for flowers to have a look at this painting, because there are so many different flowers you can discover within this painting. Then, of course, we have up here also the oranges, the fruits. Orange was a symbol of power of the Medici family within Florence. So we have so many symbolic meanings within this beautiful painting, because, as I said, without discovering all these symbols, it's such a beautiful painting. And what I want to say to finish my presentation is that today, both Simonetta Vespucci and the painter Botticelli, our painter of this beautiful painting, together their tones are within this beautiful church in Florence, whose name is Ogni Santi. You can write it down if one day you want to go to Florence. Ogni Santi Church. This was actually the quarter of the city where the painter spent all his life and had his atelier, basically. And yes, they stayed there together. And if tomorrow, one day, we can go to visit Florence, I think you may want to visit this place as well, together, of course, to the Uffizi Museum, where you can see this such a beautiful painting by Botticelli. So basically, this is it about this painting. If you have any question, any curiosity, I would be happy to respond, of course. Let me see here. Okay, so I can see you all you guys.
Why does Mercury or Mercurio, why does he have something like a sword? Because normally, I think his weapon is more, normally he doesn't have a weapon.
He doesn't have a weapon. Did you see a weapon? He has wingy shoes.
No, I mean, yeah. Normally, in the pictures that I know, or the representations that I know, I don't remember any weapon. So
there is no weapon here. Did you see any weapon?
But in his hand, this is to get away from clouds.
Exactly. This is not a weapon. This is just a specific device whose name is Caduceo. If you want to write it down, you can maybe. It's not that easy here to see it. But
yeah, it's not visible.
It's I can find it on internet and I can show it to you. It's Caduceo.
Probably the guy meant not the thing in his hand, but what is hanging on his belt.
Yes.
It is a sword. Yeah. A sword hanging on his belt.
Let me see. Okay. Okay. Well, let me clarify one thing. You know, this conference didn't mean to be a class. You know, this is an open discussion. So I'm happy to share with you guys what I know, but of course I'm not a professor. I'm not a Botticelli expert, so I just share with you guys what I know. But then, of course, I appreciate the question, and this is something I will go to I want to get some information on the different type of representation we have of Mercurio. Does anybody have an answer for Rüdiger? So why Hermes has this type of representation here? As I said, he's there to protect the garden, okay? So this is what we know. He wants to protect the garden, you know? So maybe this is the reason why he has as well. But let's go to see some other type of representation. Stay there, that I search something. So, Mercurio, let's see.
The reason why I asked this is because for me the clearest representation of the Medici family for me is Mercurio himself, because yes. he's the god of the merchants. Yeah, he's yeah. also the god of communication, so it's like a telecom.
Yeah. He's a messenger. He's a messenger.
A messenger, but because I'm a merchant myself, in a way, I know that this is another thing. Or I think for the people of that time, it was also very important that you represented bankers and merchants and these professions. So if anything in this picture is. At once, a Medici representation that it is him, and at the same time, it's interesting that he has a strong weapon, yeah. which he normally does not have. So this is like, for me, it's like a sign,
yeah.
from the Medici family saying, okay, we are bankers, we are merchants, but be careful, we are also
that's that's a very good explanation, I would say, Rüdiger. That's a very good.
That's the exact.
One thing, Caterina, one thing. In less than 1 minute, we will be disconnected. So please, when you are disconnected, you can get back in the same time, the same way you did before. We will be disconnected in a few seconds. Okay.
Are you sure? Because I think they don't disconnect after 40 minutes any longer.
I'm 99% sure that we will be disconnecting in a few seconds. But let's hope you are right. In any case, I hope I can see you again afterwards, because I want to discuss more about what Rüdiger was saying. Okay. Yes, so Caterina, you were something. Yeah, you were saying something.
I was saying that I think that the sword is exactly in relation to the Medici and to the fact that they were the guardians of the art of all these